Now, speaking on behalf of Chris and Kameron Cline will be Steve Deweese, and then Joe Perdone.
Thanks, everybody, for coming out. This is pretty great. To start with, I have a letter written by Cameron's mother, Kelly Fama, that she wrote. They read it in Florida last night, and Kelly emailed it to me this morning. And after reading it, I don't think I can get through it, so I'm going to change the program a little. There are, in the beginning of our elementary school, there was four of us that became really close friends. It was myself, Chris, and Jody Cook, and Timmy Morgan. I'd like Jody to come up and read this letter, because I'm going to change it up after I'm done. Please, Jody. Jody used to be the basketball coach at Baileysville, and they fired him. After I quit being his assistant.
Okay. He didn't know I was doing this.
No, but I'm ready. The last time I was with my precious daughter was her graduation from LSU. You could see her self-confidence, her pride, and maturity. It was breathtaking. She was ready to take on the world. Her dad sent me a text that morning before leaving LSU. The last words I would receive from Chris. He said, "Thank you for putting up with me so long, long enough to have Cameron. I feel so blessed to be able to have our kids together and enjoy an evening like tonight. It feels great to have laughed and smiled so much, my cheeks hurt. What a wonderful gift I can share with our children. For Cameron's graduation gift, I gave her a locket, in it a picture of us together as mother and precious baby girl, kissing her tiny, perfect nose. The other side would be for her and her precious baby someday. She gave me a matching infinity necklace, along with a card that read, 'The bond between mother and daughter is forever. Our bond persists through the thick and thin. We are connected biologically, but the real connection is spiritual and made of love. The flow of energy between mother and daughter is among the most powerful in nature. Yes, some days that energy is torrential, like a clashing thunderstorm, but in the end, a soaring rainbow is sure to emerge. Because we are there for each other, our unconditional love rises above all.'" She put it around my neck, and I told her I would cherish it forever. One of many lasting tributes we shared. Cammie and Rachel then went off to a great adventure to Asia, a graduation gift from her dad. I followed her travels on Find My Friends, and at times felt like I was with her. My husband texted her jokingly, claiming I was stalking her. Cameron laughingly said, "It's great to be loved." Then she flew off to celebrate her dad's birthday, making sure to schedule a flight to Lake Norman to spend time with her mama, stepdad, and a little brother before jetting off to New York to start her new life. She was supposed to arrive at my house yesterday, but God had a different plan, a much greater destination. Brittany was that once-in-a-lifetime best friend, loyal to the end, attached at the hip. If you knew her, you'd understand why. So many memories watching these girls grow up. Cameron had the best friends. Everyone tried to convince Brittany to stay on the island that night when Cammie and her friend had gotten sick. "No way. I'm going with them," she insisted. The definition of friendship: when you love someone and genuinely want them to be happy, even if it means sacrificing something yourself to make that happen. What am I going to miss about Cameron? Everything. Her eyes, her smile, cuddling, doing face masks, shopping, traveling, and of course, a big one, eating out. Always making sure to keep an eye out for a server we could be kind to. But her character and the woman she grew into, loyal, humble, kind, considerate, compassionate, one of a kind. There are just no words to describe what a beautiful, special daughter we were blessed with. What I've learned so far, the only thing that can make sense of this devastating tragedy is that God has a plan for a better life for them and greater things for those she left behind. Seems impossible to understand now, but if we can hold on to that, if we truly can, we will heal. Something great beyond our imagination has to come from this, because if it doesn't, it was for nothing. In her remembrance, put down those cell phones and embrace what's right in front of you. Be more involved in church. Read a Bible verse daily. Or give someone an extra big hug. Take time to tell and show the people in your life that you love them. And look for ways to bless others often. If we can do this, her memory will never fade. At my mother-in-law's funeral, the priest said something that gave me and my husband comfort. He said, even if she could come back, she wouldn't. I believe, right now, Cameron is looking down at us with her laid-back attitude. Why are you guys grieving about me? I'm fine. I'll leave one of Cammie's favorite sayings. Kind people are my kind of people. Just think about that. I'll carry you in my heart every day and spend the rest of my life keeping your beautiful memory alive. We love you so deeply, my precious angel. You've made us better already. Thank you. God bless you.
Okay, we're going to change it up a little bit now. This book is my daily journal, and I can tell you where I've been every day since January 1st. And Chris, probably 90% of the time I can tell you where he's at with this book. That's a joke. If you don't know, my name is Steve DeWeese. I am Chris's first cousin. And the story with that is, as we were growing up, playing sports Chris was my cousin. If we would go somewhere, they'd say, well, who's that? I'd go, that's Steve's cousin. We got his first Porsche 928. Every time we went somewhere to that, it was like, well, who's that? Oh, that's Chris's cousin. So, I'd just like to recognize some family members. They're all mostly over here. Charlie's family, Eric Cline's family, Kenny Cline's family, OG. I'm just trying to get everybody. Sean, Bill Kelly. I mean, some of them aren't family, but they are family. And it's kind of like an inner circle we had of people that, you know, we would go somewhere and they're like, sometimes everybody could go and sometimes everybody couldn't go. But we tried to make that happen as much as we could. Here put my glasses on. So I thought I'd write all this in this book so I'd have it in here. One thing before I start. Paula, I'm glad you're blocked so I can't see you. The girls, the three that I knew the most, If you saw them coming and I saw them a lot, as soon as you made eye contact with these three girls, you got a smile. And they weren't those kind of girls that had attitudes or they never, I don't know how to put it, but it, since they were teenagers, I mean, you know how some eighth graders get, I mean, it's hard to deal with, but these girls never had that stage that I know of. And I just want you all to know how special they were. And David Jude, if David Jude was your friend, it was for life. If he called you friend, you could count on it forever. And Jeff, he was British military special forces, could fly anything. I always talked to him in an Australian accent, and he would say, I'm not Australian, quit. he was really funny. And I just want to mention some people that worked for Chris and became, and Donnie is an old Rough Rider, Donnie Holcomb. He graduated with Timmy and Jody a year ahead of me and Chris. And Donnie's been like a friend and a brother, him and his brother Billy. And we got Stephanie's here. I think Stephanie's here. She's his rock in Florida. And with Beth DePolo's is rock in Beckley. And there's so many more people that work for Chris that were just wonderful people. Well, I like to say, I know there's got to be some coal miners here. If you're here, clap your hand. If you run a loader, if you do anything, man, just thank God for you. Okay? And all these people work for Chris. I mean, when we went to high school, it was like, you know, the Rough Riders here, Rebels, Indians, Minutemen. I mean, and we were all pretty much enemies in Wyoming County. There were six high schools back then. So, but then as we all graduated and we started doing things, we all became best friends, no matter which school you went to. I mean, you became friends. And then when Chris started his coal mines, everybody became, you know, they went to work for Chris. And you know, we had Rebels and Wildcats and Shady Tigers and Woodrow Wilson Flying Eagles and everybody from Wyoming County, they came to work for Chris. And he appreciated that. He trusted those people. And that's why if he goes to Canada or Illinois, he's back here having job searches, trying to get people here to go with him, because that's the people he could rely on, he could trust. So it's just it was always like a family to him, and family was very important to him. And with his mother, his father, I mean, we didn't have much when we were small. And it really hurts me when you hear some of the comments that have been made about him and how, I mean, there was no silver spoon there, believe me. And he just decided he was going to do it, and he did it. And he didn't. You know, he did it with a lot of help, and it just really bothers me when I see these headlines. They're calling him a coal baron, a coal tycoon. He'd hate that. He never did that. All he said is he hired good people and he got lucky. He never wanted to be considered a baron or a tycoon. That's not him. I mean, that's just not the way he was. But. And I envy Rob Hogan, who worked for Chris on the island. Rob got to hug him before he got on a helicopter. He got to hug the girls. I wish I could have been there for that. And I know Delaney was like, I'm going to, I'm a nurse. She just passed her boards, and Delaney's like, I'm going to be with Candy. So that's the kind of friends they were. They weren't going to leave, you know, let them leave without them. Anyway, I'm going to give you some things that you don't know about Chris. And things that he, you know, of course you see all the, he made this many million to W, to Marshall. That's not the things that the things that I took care of. And the one thing I know you didn't know is Chris had a 13-year Sunday school badge. No matter where we went, Myrtle Beach, wherever, we had to find a Baptist church for Chris to go to. We were like, gosh, man, it's Myrtle Beach or it's this. He said, I don't care, man. Mom will kill me if I don't go to Sunday school. So up until, I don't know, up until his, you know, early 20s, he was all, he was working on that pen. He's been a donor to where he grew up, Brenton Baptist Church, for since it was his dad built it. And nobody knows that Chris does that. He pays people's medical bills that nobody knows of. But if somebody has a had a problem and they needed rehab, Chris would write the checks, take them. I see him fly people in his plane to get them started, to help them. Flood victims. I've seen him take care of that. And my sons played sports here at Woodrow, and every time, you know, they won like 3 state championships, every time Chris bought jackets, he bought the rings. And nobody knew that. These kids just knew they got jackets and rings. They didn't know that we were behind the scenes pushing all this. And if we went on a long trip, say we're going to, he said, where are you going? I said, we're going to Martinsburg. He said, well, get them kids a bus. So I go out here at Coach USA and get them a bus. Those kids didn't know who got that bus. And he helped build football fields at Wyoming East, West Side. And Buck Harless called him and said, will you help me with Mingo Central? He sent money to Mingo Central. I mean, Chris had nobody, but maybe some employees that had kids going to Mingo Central. So then he steps up and does that. And every year he gives a scholarship to somebody from Woodrow, West Side, Wyoming East. You might know that one, I don't know. But every project graduation, first tee, the Cole Classic, the auto show, Chris and Donnie started here. Hospice, every golf tournament, somebody's trying to raise money, Chris gets a call. Greater Beckley. I didn't know this one this morning. Beth DiPolo told me that Chris, every year they would pick an elementary school, and I think it was Bradley last year, maybe Sophia Soap Creek the year before, and they would send him a list of people that needed hands, and Chris just, they'd go buy hands for all these people, and he'd send them over. You know, and then the sheriffs, they would ask, you know, he would donate at Thanksgiving. And, you know, when they ran low on money, the first guy you'd call would be somebody like Chris, say, hey, we're a little bit short, can you help some more? And he would do it. And this one I didn't know about, the Ladies Coal Auxiliary. He gave them money every year. Spirit of Beckley, $5,000 every year. Baileysville Middle School, 2 years ago, he bought them backboards and rims. One of our employees, one of our pilots, he paid his girls to go to California to train for beach volleyball. Now they both are playing at Florida State. And this one's a good one. Chris, when they had all the tragedy in Haiti, Chris sent stuff down there. I don't know how much it was and everything, but it never got to the people who's supposed to get it. So the next year, Chris has his two planes and the people from Christ Fellowship Church. They have an orphanage there called A Place of Hope. And I'm telling you, these children were trying to sneak into an orphanage. That's how bad it is. They were trying to get into the orphanage. So we go down there at Christmas and we're bringing all these toys. Everything these kids could need. And Chris said, we're going ourselves this time. We're going to make sure it gets to where we go because of the corruption down there. It didn't get where it was supposed to be the year before. So he says, let's just go ourselves. And it was an experience that I would see it again, but that is unbelievably how poor those people are. And Chris, he always gave to a charity called Little Smiles. And I don't know how many of y'all know Shane Maynard. Shane was the basketball star here in Beckley and a great friend of my son's. Shane passed away this past August, it'll be 2 years. Chris called me and said, take care of Shane's arrangements. So I called Mr. Maynard and I said, Chris said, do what you need to do. It's on him. So, I mean, he didn't have to do that. And then we had a state soccer tournament here, and I go to Chris and I say, Chris, Dave Larrabee, I can hear him better screaming out the window than I can over those speakers. I said, you gonna put your dad's name on something? We can't even hear it. And the bleachers on the other side. He said,
well, what's that? I said, they said $3,000 to get grade speakers. He said, well, we need to get it before the tournament. So he pulled that off. I mean, he built a place, and then, I mean, they said we had a sound system, but it wasn't that great. So Chris took care of that. Well, I want to leave you with two things. Chris and I kind of made him a country music fan. And this one is my favorite. It's I Believe by Brooks and Dunn. And it says that I'm finding more and more truth in the words that are written in red. And there's more to life than what we can see. And all this doesn't end in a slow ride in a hearse. That's not the end. Because I believe. And Chris's favorite song was Live Like You Were Dying. In 2004, we were sitting on a boat in the Southern Caribbean, and we could see the Southern Cross, perfect. And this song was out, and he said, from now on, I'm gonna live that song, I'm gonna live like I'm dying. And he said, I'm gonna try to, time is all we got. The rest of it is clutter, he said, but we got to use our time the best we can and enjoy the ride. So, in honor of Chris, it's like, when you get ready to leave today, give somebody here a hug. Or when you get home, give somebody a hug. Because you never know. You never know when it's going to be the last time. Thank you.
I'm Joe Prudhomme, and I'm an orthopedic surgeon. I got to know Chris Cline really well. Most people don't get to know their orthopedic surgeon as well as he did, but he liked to play real hard. So I worked on him a lot of time, more than a dozen. And got to be really good friends with him, and he trusted me to the point that I used to travel around the country with him, and when he had something else wrong with him that I couldn't take care of, I'd pick him the best doctor anywhere around and go with him to make sure they did a good job. So I got pretty close with him, and actually, I was closer to Chris than I am with any of my brothers or sisters, and I felt like I was part of the family. He always said I was part of the family. I didn't have to ask permission to just come walk on him whenever I wanted, so I felt pretty honored about that. Mainly, I'm here tonight to talk about Chris, but I want to start by talking about everybody, because there were seven people who all died too soon, and they had wonderful, fun, exciting lives while they were alive, and that's what we should be thinking about, is what a good life they had. I knew most of them. Some of them were close friends. David Jude was a good friend, and man, he was an awesome, awesome friend to have, because David had your back. And he gave his life trying to help his buddy and his buddy's kid. He was a careful pilot. He was a great pilot. If there was anything that he could have done to save that aircraft, he'd have done it. Dave was fantastic. And the other pilot, Jeff, he was a really good guy. I mean, he was used to getting shot at while he was flying, so he was hard to rattle. And he had more hours of flying a helicopter than just about anybody you could ever find anywhere in the world. So I'm sure with those two guys, if there was any way that helicopter could have stayed in the air, they'd have done it, and I don't have a doubt. Sometimes it's just your time. I want to talk about Cameron, because Cameron didn't talk to me that much. She just smiled, but she could say a lot with her smile. She didn't have to talk a whole lot. She made a lot of friends just by smiling and conveyed them. That this was a sweet person, and that's was the extent of my conversation with her. A lot of times it was just a big smile. Seemed to keep her friends around forever, though. And she was there with her four best girlfriends, her BFFs, and they were having the day of their life, and all even they were having a ball, and, you know, they were all joyous because they'd just finished their college degrees. Cameron and Delaney had been friends since they were in grade school. Cameron and Brittany went to high school and graduated the Benjamin School together. Their classmates did actually vote them most likely to be joined at the hip. That's how close they were. And then I think they became friends with Jillian when they were in LSU, and they were all sorority sisters. But once Cameron made friends with you and decided she liked you, you stuck around, same as her dad, Chris. So anyway, I remember those four good girlfriends just having graduated, having the time of their life on a beautiful summer day, and I hope we can all remember them that way. Chris was my buddy, but more than that, we were foxhole buddies. He's the kind of guy who had your back no matter what you would do, and just like Artie said, I'd have taken a bullet for him and him for me, and I know it for a fact. I could have called Chris from South Africa and said, Chris, I'm in I'm having a problem. I need you to come get me. He wouldn't even ask what kind of problem. He just would have said, I'm on my way. When Chris was hurt or sick, I did the same thing for him. Came any time of the day or night, anywhere, sometimes pretty far. I just dropped what I was doing, sometimes hopped on the plane in my scrubs, and I went. He was that good a friend to me. But Chris defended his friends and his loved ones fiercely. And sometimes, he even defended underdogs and unfortunate people he didn't even know that same way. That's a part of him most people don't know about. I can tell you a personal example. Chris and his foxhole buddies, Dave Jude among them, and all of us were on a motorcycle trip. We rode up the entire west coast of the United States. We took these giant Honda Gold Wings, and I was the least experienced rider. I'm used to riding a little old dirt bike, and I hopped on this giant 1,400-pound Gold Wing with my wife on the back, who's not used to riding motorcycles at all and liked to lean the wrong way. But anyway, we weren't even 5 miles into our 1,200-mile trip, and we came up on this road construction site where they'd narrowed the road down into two little bitty lanes with concrete barriers on each side. And this car behind me kept encroaching and kept pushing me over, trying to get past me. Well, he almost ran me into the barrier. Chris stopped his motorcycle right dead in the middle of the road, completely stopped the traffic, got off, ran back like a wild man, and told that guy in slightly more vituperous language that if he did that again, caused me any pain or hurt me, that it would be the last action he ever did on this earth. There were some other choice words to go with it, but he meant it. Motorcycle trips is where you really got to know Chris Cline when he didn't need any money, because you just couldn't spend much. We'd pull up our bikes with, you know, 5 or 6 people around the gas tank and fill them all up, and maybe it'd be $60, and we could all whip out our credit card and pay for it. Go, Chris, I got this one, man. Try filling up that plane? No, no. But it'd be a Go-Mart kind of place, and we'd just go in and we'd have breakfast on top of the trash can, literally. We'd get a banana or an apple and a Red Bull and drink that while we were filling up the motorcycles, and that'd be breakfast, and hop on again. Every once in a while, in one of those places, there'd be a mayonnaise jar, and it'd have a little picture of Susie on it and say, hey, Susie needs a bone marrow transplant. Do you want to donate? And Chris was the kind of guy that every once in a while, if you were in that town and you read the local paper a couple of days later, you're likely to read that some anonymous donor paid for little Susie's bone marrow transplant in full. You don't know a tenth of the things he did, because he never told you. He didn't talk about it. He just did it. Anyway, those motorcycle trips are some of my very favorite things. The girls were allowed to go along as they could pack in one saddlebag for a week. First time my wife was invited, she said, I'm a little worried. Can I just drive a convertible behind? He looked at her, he said, hell no. You either ride on the back of that thing and pack in one saddlebag, or you stay home and we'll send you pictures. Anyway, there are just dozens and dozens of things that he did. Steve told you a lot of them, putting kids through college, paying for dozens of people to go to rehab, to, you know, building doggy rescue centers. I mean, just on and on and on. He helped build buildings, not just donations, but build buildings at Marshall, at WU, at Beckley College, at WU Tech here now. We're trying to build a new YMCA for you guys back here. That's the last thing we were doing. I was trying to help him raise money, and we got a lot to build a brand new auditorium and YMCA complex back here on this hill behind us. That's going to be one of the most beautiful things you ever see. And now I got to make sure it's done, because it needs to be his memorial. Anyway, he also paid for a lot of the soccer complex where we sit. But for everything you know about, I assure you there are at least a dozen random acts of kindness, large and small. Anybody who was hurt or sick or fell on hard times that he knew about, even people he didn't know, he took care of. He took wonderful care of his coal miners. If one of them got hurt, he took care of their families. He took care of everything. He pulled out all the stops. He invested more in safety in his mines than anybody else around, and he did everything that he possibly could with machines to keep people from having to endanger themselves. He would always go down there himself, and he wanted to know what those guys were going through, so he was always down in the mines to know what his men experienced, and most of those guys love him. I think you all know he pulled himself up by his bootstraps, so you know the stories that he started out in a used house trailer. But he never forgot where he came from. And he'd be the first to tell you that no amount of hard work and brains was enough to make you a billionaire. You needed a lot of luck, too. And there's a lot of luck in Chris Cline's story. But Chris, in addition to being lucky, Chris was bold, and he was hardworking, and he was smart and wise, and he was a generous guy. Every time I spent a week with Chris, I'd come away a better person for it. He made me feel like I could do more. Made me braver. Made me more creative. He made me more inquisitive. He made me work harder and smarter. Chris was a huge presence in my life. For that matter, in most of our lives for about a year. And man, it's been big fun. He trusted his family and friends and treated us to the most amazing experiences. And, you know, as he made more money, he'd take you to more amazing things. Because he would say, they can take away all your money, but they can't take away your memories. As his success built, he treated us to more things, but he also kept getting bigger boats and bigger planes. A lot of people thought that, you know, was showing off. It wasn't showing off. That's because he hated leaving anybody behind. He wanted every single one of us to get to have those wonderful experiences. And he loved to sit down and look at the pictures and reminisce about it over popcorn and, you know, talk about how amazing that was. And he would always say, remind me of that. I don't want to forget the details. I want to, when I'm old, I want to be able to remember that. It was just something he loved to do. Anyway, Chris knew what mattered most, and that's family and friends and experiencing that all this world had to offer. He wanted it all. He wanted to try everything before he died. He wanted to make memories together and share them with everybody he loved. And he loved seeing everybody together playing and laughing and engaged in friendly competition whenever that was possible, too, because he did love to compete. I guess Chris used to say that no amount of money could buy you an extra minute on this earth, and that when your time was up, it was up. Once again, he was right. On the 4th of July, one of his favorite days of the year, he loved fireworks. Chris Cline's wonderful, exciting, successful, generous life was snuffed out suddenly and way too soon. And I want to remember and celebrate every second of that charmed life, except for the very last few. Chris, I'll miss you, and no doubt I'll think about you most days and rest of my life. You're the coolest guy I ever met.
What it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees? can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
For those of you who have any doubt that God is with us tonight, if you'll all turn around and look at this beautiful sunset in the sky, and the way he sheltered us from, I think, an 80% chance of rain this evening. So thank you again so much for coming out this evening, this beautiful vigil. And at this time, I'll ask our new pastor of the Presbyterian Church, Monty Mitchell, to excuse us through a prayer. Thank you very much.
Lord God, you have heard all of the joys, and we thank you for that. But you also know that in our hearts, there is great sorrow, there is great misery. And we have no better helper than you. No one else can help because our misery is so great. But we know that you work through the hands and feet of those who love you. And so we would ask that you help us do the things that we can do. Be your hands and feet in the world, that we listen, that we hold dear those who suffer. We ask that you help us in this misery, for you are stronger than all the misery and death in the world. For we know that nothing in life or in death can separate us from your love. And so for these seven souls, for each other, we depend on your grace and mercy, and we lift our prayers to you in the name of Jesus. And we give you thanks that Jesus prays for all of us. Amen. Amen.